baptism. Now, baptism does not wash away our sins, but it shows that our sins have been washed away, that we've been forgiven by Jesus Christ. It also shows that as Christ was died on the cross and was raised again, that when we come to faith in Christ, we die to the old self and we are raised to new life in Christ. So thank God for his redemption, and may he be glorified today. Justice, come on down. Now, Justice is our first one to be baptized today. This is Darnell and Michelle's children. Excited to have you here today. And upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I come to you, my brother in Christ, to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, and raised to walk in newness of life. Great to see you here today, Jair. And Jair, too, has professed his faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And he is coming today to be obedient to Christ, follow him in baptism, to show that his sins have been forgiven and that he now has new life through Jesus Christ. My pleasure today to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk. Christ, we thank you for Jair and Justice, for their families, for this church. We thank you, God, for the salvation that they have in Jesus Christ. And I pray, God, today as they have taken this step of obedience, of coming to proclaim and profess their faith in Jesus before this church, that God, you would just bless them, that your Holy Spirit would fill them, Lord, and anoint their lives, that they grow, Lord, in Christ to maturity, and God, may they be in great health in the Spirit. And I pray, God, that we as a family and a church family will be here, Lord God, to help raise and to guide them in Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today we'll be in the Gospel of Mark and chapter 7. So you turn your Bible to Mark chapter 7. And we'll be looking at a teaching of Jesus Christ that is very, very important. And one that the Pharisees had a hard time understanding. The disciples had a hard time understanding. And we today even have a hard time understanding. Mark chapter 7, I want to ask the question, what makes someone unclean? What is the source of sin? Now, just before the passage we're going to read today in verse 14, the Pharisees are asking Jesus, why are your disciples eating with unclean hands? Not meaning that their hands were physically dirty, but they had not gone through the ceremonial washing necessary to be ceremonial clean for the eating. And Jesus used the opportunity to teach them about sin. Where does sin come from? And this is very important. And sin is important. You know, the story of Scripture is a story about sin. And about redemption. And how sin brings pain and division and death and hurt and loss. So we have to be cured of sin, we have to know what sin is, to recognize sin. And then we have to know how God has worked to bring us out of that. Sin is destructive. You see the flames here in the picture. Sin destroys. Fire destroys. What's one of the fires? Is it consumed, right? If a house catches on fire, it consumes the wood, the materials of the home. Whatever is burned up is consumed. Sin does that. Sin destroys. And that's why sin is so serious and why Jesus talked about sin. Well, let's look at Mark chapter 14, or chapter 7, begin with verse 14. And this is after the encounter with the Pharisees talking about being clean and unclean. It says, summoning the crowd again, he told them, listen to me, all of you, and understand. Now, when Jesus says that, he's about to teach something that may is simple to say, but hard to grasp, hard to understand. He says, nothing that goes into a person from outside can defile him, but the things that come out of a person are what defile him. When he went into the house, away from the crowd, his disciples asked him about the parable. They didn't understand it. What does this mean? And he said to them, are you also lacking in understanding? Don't you realize that nothing going into a person from the outside can defile him? For it doesn't go into his heart, but into his stomach, and is eliminated. Thus he declared all foods clean. He said, what comes out of a person is what defiles him. He says, from within, out of people's hearts, come evil thoughts, sexual immoralities, thefts, murders, adulteries, greed, evil actions, deceit, self-indulgence, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile a person. Let's pray. Our Father, we pray this morning that as we hear the words of Jesus, God, that you would open our eyes, open our ears, enable us, Lord God, to understand and to receive the truth that Jesus taught us. We pray this in his name. Amen. You know, a lot of people don't like it when we talk about sin, hell, judgment, those kinds of things, because Christianity is supposed to be about peace and love. Well, the reason that Jesus talks a lot about sin and about judgment is because he loves you, because he loves us. And he doesn't want us to suffer. He doesn't want us to be separated from God. He doesn't want us to die in sin. You see, he understands what the cause of the problems are. And he, of course, is the solution to those problems. He's the answer to those things. Now, we read this at one level, and of course, this is very simple to understand. It's what's in my heart. I looked out there. But that's not really how we live many times in our lives. You know, so often we think that it's my friends or the society or the culture or the TV or something that makes me sin. But Jesus said that's not what makes you sin. He said there's something inside of me. There's something inside of you. There's something inside of us that makes us sin. And we have to realize that sin is first and foremost not a mistake. It's not something taboo. It's not something that people don't approve of. Sin is something that we do that goes against God. And that's why it's sin. You see, God is holy. God is just. Life comes from God. And when we sin against God, we're sinning against the very giver and sustainer of life itself. And it causes a broken relationship, and it causes destruction. So we need to realize that sin is serious because sin is a rebellion against God, against the character of God, the nature of God, and it separates us from God. We need to know what sin is. We need to know that it's serious. And one way to understand sin is to understand God. One of the most important characteristics of God is a characteristic of faithful love. And sin goes against faithful love. One of the ways you can evaluate whether or not something is sinful, or what's going on in my thoughts, my heart, whatever is sinful, is does this desire, does this wish, does this thing I'm trying to get that I want to do, that I'm saying, does it exemplify faithful love? Now, of course, love is an attitude towards somebody else. It's an attitude that says, I care about you. You're important to me. I want the best for you. I want a relationship with you. And faithful means it's continuous. It's not dependent upon the person. You see, God's love for us isn't dependent upon us. And when our love for someone becomes dependent upon them, then we're turning away from God. We turn away from faithful love. Because God's love is faithful. We see throughout the story of history, as God called His people, He loved His people, He delivered His people, He gave Himself to His people, that they would turn away in sin and idolatry. And yet He still loved them. Doesn't mean there's not consequences. Doesn't mean there's not judgment. But God always loves, and God is seeking to redeem and restore. So God is faithful love. In Psalm 118, verse 1, it says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His faithful love endures forever." If you want to understand sin, you got to understand faithful love. And anything that undermines, goes against faithfully loving God and faithfully loving others is going to be sin. In verse 5, the psalmist says, "I called to the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and put me in a spacious place." It's like going from prison to freedom. I was in distress. The world was closing in around me. My enemies were coming after me. I was failing. I had nowhere to go. There was no hope. It was darkness. But I called out to the Lord to save me. And what did he do? He brought me out into His freedom. So we need to understand that sin is serious because sin destroys. But the good news is that God came deliver us from sin. Well, this morning I want to look at what Jesus taught was sin. And I want you to think about these things and say, is this in my heart? Or what in the heart would call someone to do these things? Where's the source? And because we've got to be able to recognize sin and where it comes from. The first thing he said was sin was evil thoughts. Now, evil thoughts are what? Well, you can think it may be something really far out there that some horrible, horrendous mass murderer might be plotting. But an evil thought is really something that I'm thinking about, I'm planning in my mind, that's going to do what? That's going to bring harm to somebody else. It didn't have to be murder to harm somebody. See, an evil thought means I'm scheming, I'm planning, I'm thinking, I'm working in my mind somehow to do something. Maybe it's just something that's going to make me happy and get my way and get what I want. And I don't care that it is going to hurt somebody else. You see, it's an evil thought. I'm thinking and I'm planning and I'm scheming and I'm working to do something, to get something. But when I do it, it may bring pleasure to me, but it's going to be harmful to someone else. Evil thoughts. He says sexual immoralities. Now, this is a sin that has been totally rejected by Western society. Pop culture. Pop culture doesn't believe in sexual immorality. The only sexual immorality is non-consent. Anything else is fine and good. So why would Jesus say that sexual immorality is evil? Because it is the opposite of faithful love. Sexual immorality and adultery, which he lists later, are the opposite of faithful love. When God created Adam and Eve, he said the two shall what? Shall become one flesh. What does that mean? That's faithfulness. They're going to be faithful to one another for a lifetime. He said that's the foundation of a healthy marriage and a healthy family. Faithful love. Now, what's the opposite of that? Well, it's seeking sexual pleasure outside of marriage. See, sex was designed to be one of the ways that a man and a woman come together in unity and have children, but also one of the ways they come together into oneness. And so we're engaging in sexual immorality, which means sexual pleasure sexual activity outside of marriage, we're seeking to indulge ourselves, or another one of the sins that he lists in his improper place. So I'm really using sex to bring pleasure to myself. And I'm not doing it the way God designed it, which was to be as an expression of faithful love to a husband or to a wife. So whether it's pornography or lust or premarital sex or whatever it might be, it's going against God in faithful love. See, marriage is one of the pictures of our relationship with God. Between Israel and God, between the church and Christ, it says we're like a husband and a wife, a bride and a groom. Why? Because it displays faithful love. And faithful love gives life, it gives peace, it gives beauty, it gives wonder and awe. And so Jesus says this is an evil. And today it's just, well, if nobody gets hurt, it's okay, right? But it does hurt. You say, well, how does it hurt anybody? Well, number one, it hurts first and foremost because it's rebellion against God. And there's nothing more important in your life or my life than my relationship to God. Now we think, well, it doesn't matter. It does matter. It's, well, God loves me. Yes, but it doesn't mean there aren't consequences. People will die and go to hell that God loves. Why? Maybe they just took it for granted, I'll do my own thing, and God will just have to take care of me. But sexual immorality. He says theft. What is theft? Well, theft is not love, is it? It's not faithfulness to anyone. It's saying, I want something that's not mine, and I'm going to take it from you. And that happens at all different levels. He says this is evil. Why? Because it's not faithful love. It's selfishness. It's harm to another person. Murders. You can't turn on the TV today without seeing a story about a murder. Right? And murders are going on everywhere, in every town, every local news channel. The top news of the day is usually more than one murder that's taking place. Well, why do people kill each other? Well, today they say people kill each other because we have guns. Or people kill each other because of poverty. Or people kill each other because of injustice. But there's something inside of us that leads us to do these things. Now, not everybody murders, right? Okay? But the sin that leads to murder is in all of us. Because Jesus is rooted in anger and in hatred towards others. Now, what Jesus is saying is that the sin is in the person, not those things out there. Most people don't murder. Most people will never murder. Some will. So why would some not? Well, things going on in the heart. But the other part of this is, what is the influence of culture, of society, of those things? Well, the culture, the friends, the society you're going up in doesn't create the sin inside of us. But it can inflame it. It's like if inside of me is the flame of sin, that stuff I'm putting into my head, that person out there doesn't make the sin be there, but it can be like gasoline on a match. It can cause an inferno. So it can feed that. One of the things that happens in culture, in social networking, how we relate to our friends, our peers, whatever, is our peers, our friends, our family, our culture, teaches us how to express our sin. You see, that's one of the things that culture does. It may be since a very mild kind of thing, in a very civilized and mild context, might be, well, here's how you express your sin. I remember when I was driving limousines one time, and one lady was riding the back there, and she was telling a story to another person, and talking about somebody, and she goes, and she's been in the grocery store, she's talking to the person, and she goes, I just told her, just write her off your list. Okay? That might be a very civilized way of expressing your anger and hatred. It's just write them off. Don't have anything to do with them, exclude them, push them out, because that's how you express it. Well, in another context, maybe the way they express their hatred and their anger is just to kill them. They don't just write them off with a piece of paper or with a silence, but actually murder. So where's the sin? The sin is in the heart. It's the anger and the hatred towards that other person. That's why in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said that if you hate in your heart, you committed murder. Not that you actually killed somebody, but the sin behind it is there. And that's true with all these things. So we might express our sin in different ways. We may be in a situation where, hey, this expression of sin is okay. Why? My friends accept it, my peers accept it, the culture accepts it, it's all right. But that doesn't mean it's all right with God. Because when it goes against faithful love, it is sin against God. He says adultery. So of course, this is a very obvious thing. But people today figure that if you're not satisfied, right? If you're not satisfied with your spouse, well, you deserve satisfaction. You deserve more than what he or she is giving you. Therefore, it's okay to betray your husband or your wife and walk away and get what you want, right? You deserve it. It's what you deserve. It should be okay. And that's how we live in our culture. Why is that so bad? Because it's not faithful love. It's actually the picture of unfaithfulness. To walk away from someone that you have pledged yourself to. So it's adultery when we enter into that kind of thing. Greed. I remember hearing a talk show host say many times over and over again, there's no such thing as greed. You can't define greed. There is no greed. You know, it's like a kind of some kind of a leftist made up thing. But what is greed? Well, we think of greed as an excessive want. But what makes it sin is that our desire to have money or to have a boat or a house or a car or a vacation, whatever, our desire for that thing causes what? To sin. Maybe I'm a sin against my family because I'm going to neglect the needs of my family. You see, that's unfaithful and it's not love. What? In order to get that thing that I want. See, that's greed. Maybe greed is manifested in I really want something, and so I will steal to get that. Greed can be manifested in life for Christians that rather than giving to the kingdom of God in generosity and faithfulness, I will withhold my tithes and offerings. Why? So I can have this over here that I want. You see, that's greed. Greed means that I'm pursuing something in a way that causes me to sin against God or against someone else. Because greed, you see, the thing, the material thing, has a higher priority than our faithful love to God and to other people. Greed, he says evil actions. All right, and of course it can be anything, right? He says it springs out of us. The devil didn't make me do it. My friend didn't make me do it. My wife, my child, my parent, they didn't make me do it. I did it. And if I want to change, I got to take responsibility. Now, they can influence. They can fan the flame. They can help build it up. They can teach me ways to express my sin. But it comes out of the heart, Jesus says. Deceit. That's just misrepresenting. Lying. You know, we get a lot of lying in politics. It's like, it's just an acceptable thing to do. Well, that's what you do when you're running for office. You lie, right? That's what we do. We don't expect any politician to keep their promises. You know, if their side doesn't keep the promises, they're evil. If our side doesn't keep the promises, well, it's okay, right? So we have accepted deceit because we're taught by society that deceit is necessary to get what you want. Why? Because deceit is what you do to manipulate people. You tell people what they want to hear. So they'll respond to you in the way you want them to respond, so you'll get what you want. That's deceit. And that happens all the time. Why? Because what I want is good. If I'm in power, if I'm the boss, if I get to have my way, then everything will be better, and therefore it's okay to deceive. But Jesus says that deception is evil. Self-indulgence. This, of course, is just preoccupation with me. This is the emotion-driven life. This is what I feel. This is what's in my heart. This is what I desire. I can't deny that thing in me. I've got to have it. I'm going to indulge myself. And of course, I mean indulging my what? My flesh, my passions, my lust, my desires, even when that indulgence is going to hurt me. Self-indulgence. Another, he says, is envy. Envy. How many friendships have been broken because of envy? It begins as little kids. One child jealous of another child because they get recognition, they get something, they have a friend, they get to go somewhere, and there's envy. And it just grows and grows and grows with this. And envy is probably one of those things that divides us more than anything else. Is, you know, I don't like you because you've got something that I want. And I'm envious. I'm jealous. Jesus says that's evil. Slander. Of course, slander is trying to build a coalition against somebody else. There's somebody that I don't like. There's somebody that I want to bring down. And so I'm going to start speaking to other people to malign that person. Why? Because I want to bring them down. Jesus says that's an evil. Pride. I, me, mine. Everything revolves around me. You know, one of the common manifestations of pride that I see is that when people are looking at other people, when they're looking at the future, when they're looking at what somebody said or somebody did, their first response is, how does that affect me? Do I like that? Do I don't like that? Is that good for me? Is it bad for me? Is that going to help me get what I want or not help me get what I want? And it's like everything that happens is evaluated through the lens of how is that going to affect me? See, that's pride. That's me first. That's saying that I am superior and that I should get what I want and what other people do and say should somehow serve me. See, pride puts itself above another person. And believes that other people, even God, should function in a way that serves me. Why? Because what I want is good and right and justified. And you should serve my desire. Foolishness. Now, foolishness is just craziness, right? It's like you're just being foolish. It means there's no restraint. There's no wisdom. It's just impulsiveness, just going out and doing things. And you say, well, he's just crazy. She's just crazy. But I tell you, foolishness can bring a lot of pain and a lot of hurt. What's foolishness? Drunk driving, right? What's foolishness? Taking unnecessary risks. What's foolishness? Gambling with your money. What's foolishness? Gambling with your life or other people's lives. It's foolishness. And Jesus says that it is evil. So as I said at the beginning, one of the great characteristics of God is faithful love. And so how can we have that faithful love? How can we deal with the sin in me and allow the faithful love of God to operate? Well, it's just the opposite of the normal way. See, the normal way, I've got sin. And my friends, my peers, are going to teach me how to express that sin in a way that's acceptable to them, right? Well, how do we do the opposite? Well, one, we got to deal with the sin. And then we need to have God, Jesus Christ, His Word, the Holy Spirit, teach us how to respond to that sin, that temptation, so that we can have victory over it and live with faithful love. As the psalmist said, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His faithful love endures forever. I called to the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and put me in a spacious place. What does that mean? That means the Lord set me free. He set me free. And that's what we're going to be looking at in the next few weeks. How do we deal with this sin inside of us? Well, we know we deal with it through the cross. But how do we appropriate it to ourselves? And how do we walk in that? Because that's what Jesus came to do. He said He came to give us new life. That means a changed life, a transformed life, a new life, a a new way of looking at things, a new way of living. So be with us next week and in the coming weeks as we look at how we can deal with sin and walk in that spacious place of freedom that God gives to us. Let's stand together and pray.